has not been subjected to a surgical side of treatment, and they have been sent to supportive or systemic treatment. If the patient is operable, then the second thing you need to see is there a possibility of recovery of the neurological deficit which the patient has. If the patient, usually in a metastatic disease, if the neurological deficit has been more than 48 hours, they usually do not recover even after decompression. So in these cases, it's better to go for a supportive treatment rather than going ahead with a aggressive surgery. And depending upon then the emergency, if it's an emergency situation and the patient has not been properly worked up, probably it's better to go ahead and do a decompression, simple decompression. Or if you're doing it in a planned way, then you can plan for surgeries like an end block resection. In 2008, Bartel came up with they introduced the concept of using the steroids, and a 16 milligram dose of steroid per day is advisable till the patient gets operated when they have a neurological deficit. And they also introduced the role of bisphosphonates in patients having pain due to impending instability, and the use of vertebroplasty and kyphoplasty. But there is always a doubt in our minds, how unstable is this particular spine? When you see a patient in the OPD with a tumor involving the complete vertebra and lytic area involving almost half or three-fourths of it, and it has still not fractured, it's always a difficult decision to make whether you need to go in straight away for a fixation, do you need to go for a kyphoplasty, or do you want to still observe him with the brace. So the Fisher group, they came up with this scoring system in 2010. It's called the Spine Instability Neoplastic Score. So what they have done is they have taken six components. They have taken first is the location, that is all junctional areas, they have scored them high. Lytic lesions, they have scored them high. At the same time, if there is more than 50% collapse, if there is involvement of the posterior elements, the score goes up. And with this score, wherein a maximum of 18 is possible, if your score is between 13 to 18, the spine is definitely unstable and probably he requires a surgical fixation. Whereas if the score is 0 to 6, probably the instability part is not much. The 7 to 12 score is again an indeterminate part, and it depends on the patient's symptom, on the surgeon discretion, you think at that point of time is the best solution. And so in this particular group, if you want to intervene, probably a vertebroplasty or kyphoplasty may have some role. With this knowledge, the CEPO group, they came up with their recommendations and the algorithm. This algorithm looks really complex, but I've just divided it into two parts. The simple thing to look at it is that what they have done is first they have analyzed whether the Tokuhashi scale is it less than 8 or more than 8, and if it is less than 8, then they have recommended to go for a short course radiotherapy. If it is more than 8, then they have analyzed whether there has been a neurological deficit, and if deficit has been more than 48 hours. If it has been more than 48 hours, again supportive treatment is recommended. If it is less than 48 hours, then they go on to that Fisher score, and if the Fisher score is less than 8, then probably the spine is stable, and if it's more than 8, the spine is unstable and you need to operate. These are just a few cases we have done. This is a lady, 59 year old. She had a solitary metastasis in the upper lumbar area, and what we have done is a vertebrectomy one level with a cage insertion. This slide I've borrowed from the Tomita paper, just to show the end block spondylectomy and how you can remove the complete vertebra in cases of a solitary mets and allow no seeding of the tumor. There's another patient with multiple metastasis. Primary was a CL lung, and she presented to us with a progressive deficit. This was her MRI, and since she had a CL lung with multiple mets, we decided to go in only for a palliative treatment wherein a decompression and a pedicle screw fixation was done. So no tumor excision or a corpectomy was done in this case. This is another guy, he presented to us with only left-sided L3-4 weakness with radiculopathy and pacemaker in situ with two stents. So he was a high-risk guy. We couldn't do the MRI because of the pacemaker. These were the CT scans. And so we decided to, and we were advised not to use much of electrocautery. So we decided to go minimal invasive in him. And we did pedicle screw fixation, only short segment on one side. And from the other side, we could insert again. This is the incision line. And so to conclude, the choice of most suitable treatment is of crucial importance. And functional prognosis associated with various treatment modalities is markedly affected by the actual survival period of the patients. So as surgeons, we must look at each patient as a whole and not just the radiology or even neurology, and then take our decision. Thank you.
Thank you. The lecture is open for discussion. Any question, please?
It's just that, you know, the audience is such a general audience that talk. What is your message for the youngsters sitting here if they see a patient with metastasis in three lines? I think that's what the young spine surgeons.
Yeah, I think the message is that first, when you see a metastasis, first thing is you need to work the patient up completely. Do not get into the surgical side of it until unless you're sure what it is, because they can be sometimes very vascular, and sometimes we may be doing surgeries which are unnecessary. So first thing is we must not enter into these patients unless and until it is an emergency, and then probably it's just an introduction to you about the various tools which are available, which can help you in guiding you in taking sound decisions, what to do next, what is the best thing to do for the patient. Probably both of the things.
Thank you. Thank you. The next speaker is Dr. Mihir Bapat. He'll be speaking on vertebrectomy in spinal tumors.
I thank you all for this wonderful opportunity. Vertebral resection is a very technical topic. Now, let us understand what it means and a few guidelines about how it is done. The primary tumor type, as Ankur mentioned, primary tumor type is the one that helps to decide what kind of surgery is applicable in a tumor, in a particular case of a tumor. So basically, tumors are divided into three types. You can have benign aggressive tumors like giant cell tumors, aneurysmal bone cysts, etc. You can have primary malignant tumors, chondrosarcomas, osteosarcomas, etc. And you can have metastatic tumors. Now, these are the three particular situations that we deal with. Now, whenever there is a tumor in the bone, you have to understand how it spreads. Now the tumor mostly begins in the anterior column. It is in the center of the body or in the posterior part of the body, and there are certain natural barriers to the spread of this tumor. The strong ones are the anterior longitudinal ligament, the end plates and the disc, whereas the weak barriers are the posterior longitudinal ligament and the periosteum. So naturally, if you see a tumor like this, the strong barrier would come from here. That means that the tumor would not spread like this, or the tumor would not go into the disc space. So how does the tumor spread? So the tumor would spread like this. It would spread anterolaterally there, or it would go directly into the spinal canal. And that is why neurological deficits as well as metastasis can occur early in aggressive tumors. Now, this is where the treatment protocols become important, because you have complicated cases presenting earlier. So this is where we come to the reactive zone. Now, whenever we want to resect any tumor, we want to see whether we can go all around the tumor. So for that, you have to understand what is the reactive zone. The reactive zone is formed by the periosteum as well as the loose connective tissue around the tumor. Now, this loose connective tissue can be here anterolaterally, but it can't be here posteriorly. So obviously, in spine, getting the tumor out from the spinal canal is the biggest challenge. Now, we have ill-defined tumor margins, particularly when there is an epidural spread, like I just pointed out. When you have aggressive tumors and the body does not get time to contain it, so if you have aggressive metastatic tumors which are directly adherent to the viscera, you will not have a pseudocapsule, or if you have a recurrence. And therefore it is mandatory that the first time when you attack a tumor, attack it completely, because when you have a recurrence, you cannot attack it. It always means that you will debulk it. You cannot remove it the second time. So now whenever we deal with any tumor margins, there are basically three types of tumor margins: intralesional, wide excision and radical. Now, are these possible in the spine? That is where the whole debate lies. So when you have a tumor like this, you can go wide here, you can go through the normal tissue there, you can go wide there. That means you can remove the posterior elements without touching the tumor. However, you can go wide there. That means you can always cut through the disc and try to remove the whole body. But you have to be intralesional or marginal here because you cannot cut through the aorta. And you have to be intralesional there where the tumor is entering into the spinal canal. So when we talk of R-block resections, they are never R-block resections. So why is R-block resection so important? That brings us to this topic. So if you look at the Tomita article, in fact, Tomita says that the tumors which are well circumscribed like this, that means inside the bone, they have advocated conservative approach. Now the dilemma is when you can remove this tumor, why conserve it? So that's the dilemma in his paper, whereas the R-block resections are usually done for this, where you know that there is going to be contamination. So if you have a bigger tumor, you are trying to resect it R-block. When you have a smaller tumor, you are treating it with chemotherapy. So that's the debate. Now why is this happening? Because the oncologist have created two different situations. One is if you remove the tumor piecemeal, that means you break the vertebral bodies into smaller parts and you remove the tumor piecemeal, then you leave behind large chunks of tumor. This is known as residual tumor. And residual tumor has a bigger chance of recurrence than contamination. So this situation is worse for chemotherapy than this situation, where you have little tumor contaminating from here and little tumor contaminating from there, but the whole vertebral body comes off en masse. So you have lesser tumor to treat, lesser viable cells to treat. So that is why R-block resections become more important. So when you have to minimize tumor contamination, how do you do it? Pre-op chemotherapy, pre-op embolization, use clear-cut margins like a diamond T-saw or a giggly saw that is used in R-block resections, and then you treat the residual tumor margins with distal water or intra-op chemotherapy. So this is the way you reduce the tumor contamination and improve the surgical results. Now, while doing R-block resections, they have shown very clearly that you should have negative margins so that your post-operative survival rates would increase. So you have to go wider and wider to the tumor when it is possible. Now, this is what they have shown in benign aggressive tumors. That means they have a 5-year survival rate of 100% when you resect it R-block. And this is the advantage of removing a tumor completely. Now, it is interesting that R-block resection is, I would like to remove a tumor R-block. This is what everyone says. Now, this is what Tomita also says, that my blood loss reduced from 5 liters to 1.5 liters after years of experience. And all these methods, which I told you, embolization, anesthesia, ligation of segmental vessels, fibrin glue, evolution in surgical technique, all this has helped to reduce the complication rates. So this is what Tomita said. But now if you look at all other reports in literature on R-block, minimum blood loss 5 liters, mortality rate almost 10%, aortic dissections, neurological deteriorations, durotomies, infections, implant failures, others, the complication rates are close to 50 to 60%. And that is why R-block resection is not very easy to perform. Now, these are the common observations that primary spinal tumors are only 4.2%, of which the commonest is only 1%. And that is why anyone to be Tomita with such a huge experience on spinal tumors is simply impossible. And therefore, going into R-block resections without proper preparation is just inviting trouble. So now if you compare piecemeal vertebrectomy versus R-block resections, Now, if you see, the primary tumor had a 5-year survival rate of 40%, which has increased by 10% with R-block resections, or 20% with R-block resections. In the metastatic group, 30% has become 40%. So the improvement after R-block resection is statistically significant, but there is an even greater statistical significance when it comes to complications. And that is why, unless you are very prepared, the surgeon and the patient should choose between radical excision and potentially devastating complications against piecemeal vertebrectomy with higher recurrence. Most of these patients are young with normal life expectations. So if you have a young patient whom you have done an R-block resection and put him on bed permanently, is not acceptable. And that is why you have to treat all these patients very, very carefully. Now, surgical vertebrectomy is R-block excision versus piecemeal excision supported with adjuvant chemo and radiotherapy. Now, this has been already covered by Ankur. The four basic prognostic factors are primary tumor type and grade, health status of the patient, neurological status of the patient, and whether you have treatable metastasis. So you have other metastasis which can be treated, then you do an R-block resection. If your other metastasis are going to be life threatening, do not do aggressive surgeries. That is the basic aim of treating these patients. Now, we have treated 19 such patients. I'm not going to go into this. We have had our share of complications. You have infections, you have recurrences, you have implant loosening. One patient became a multiple myeloma, early post-operative deaths. So all these are very common. So let us look at this 21-year-old lady, a lady who just finished her engineering education, wanted to take up a big job, complained of spinal pain. This was a picture. Treated with tuberculosis treatment for about 6 months without a biopsy. This was the MRI. Now, the pain kept on worsening. She had a 13-centimeter ovarian metastatic tumor. So she underwent the bilateral ovarian, the ovary excisions with radical hysterectomy. The next step was to tackle this. So we did a resection of the vertebra with anterior and posterior stabilization. Now, this patient remained stable with chemotherapy. The average survival rate of these tumors is about 4 years. Luckily, she remained stable up to 6th year, and now she's got a recurrence. This is the latest which I came to know about 2 months back. So she underwent pre-op chemotherapy, primary tumor radical surgery.
Sorry. All of this. Where did it go?
It's moving on its own. Yeah. So she underwent pre-op chemotherapy, then she underwent primary tumor radical therapy, then she underwent post-op chemotherapy. She had a positive PET after chemotherapy, then she underwent a vertebrectomy, and then post-op chemotherapy and local radiation. This was her complete treatment for 6 years. Then there is a 65-year-old lady who came with paraparesis like this, was diagnosed with a biopsy, proven to be chordoma. Now this 65-year-old lady was told that this is the end. At 65, you cannot do anything. But one must not forget that this tumor can be excised, and this is what was done. But what we forgot is the osteoporosis. So these screws came out, then we extended the implant. This was 6 months to 5 years this implant stood. Then the implant started loosening out, so we removed the implant, and this is the patient. After, how do you click on this? Now that's the result after 5 years. Now this lady is 95 kilos with minus 3.2 osteoporosis on the BMD. So this is a 40-year-old lady, biopsy proven plasmacytoma. Now if you see this tumor, really doing an ablock resection is just not possible. It is just not possible because you have to enter into the tumor. So because it's a plasmacytoma, you can use your adjuvant and chemo radiotherapy. This is a 2-year tumor free interval. Luckily the graft even after radiotherapy has consolidated. So it is not that radiotherapy is always bad for the graft. If you do a good fusion, it will still work at the end of 2 years. This is a 60-year-old lady with CA breast. The breast surgery was done 13 years back. Now when you have a 13-year-old surgery with a recurrence, it is usually a bad prognosis. That is what the breast surgeons believe. So this was a solitary mets at that time. Nothing elsewhere. Again, ablock resection really not possible. So piecemeal excision done. Radiotherapy, you can see the bone partially fused, not probably here, but the cage is okay. This is at 2 years. The patient remains stable. At 2.5 years, the patient developed metastasis here, metastasis here, but importantly, no local recurrence. So with a piecemeal excision, with radiotherapy and chemotherapy, the patient has still not got a local recurrence. So even if you select between your ablocks and your piecemeal well, you can still have a good sort of result instead of being biased for one particular surgery. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any question, please? No question? I think this is the last lecture of this session, and we come to end of this session.
One is the one that we discuss in our annual meetings, that is at a different level. And here we know that the audience want to take up the career as young spine surgeons or orthopedic surgeons. So we'll go a little low at our standard of talk so that you understand what we are saying. My intention is not to confuse you. Chairman, I disagree with debates personally, because there is no debating. What we have done 20 years ago is considered rubbish in orthopedics and spine surgery, and what we do today may be considered the same after another 20 years. It's important that we discuss. Why we should discuss is because that's how we tend to learn what is good and what is bad for our patients. We all do cervical disc replacements. There is no doubt about it. In fact, I've done one about 10 days ago. But this is a girl whose brother lives in Leeds in UK. He went through the literature and demanded that I do a cervical disc replacement. I come from Hyderabad. Every dog and human being in Hyderabad has a relative in USA or Germany or somewhere. And as Dr. Satish Rudrapura from Bangalore says, they all enter our rooms with 3 volumes of internet information. So first you have to look at this guy and then decide the treatment rather than looking at the x-rays and MRIs. I'm going a little slow because we have a lot of time. So we all do this procedure. There's nothing wrong with this procedure. But I'll finish in time. So it's good if you do it. And this is the gold standard that we have been doing for decades now. And there is nothing wrong with this procedure. It is easy to do. Less brain is required. In any complex procedure, if it is made simple, then that becomes a successful procedure. I will not discuss about the money involvement. All my patients can afford what I do. There is no problem whatsoever. I will also not talk about industry push because we are two biggest, we are all two big spine surgeons. Nobody can push us to do one surgery or the other. We are too smart and we have enough clientele not to bother about Medtronic or whoever they are to tell us that this is better than the other thing. And we have sufficient experience. So we'll take out the money aspect and the industry push. The Journal of Spine Arthroplasty Society, they did a randomized trial comparing 103 artificial discs with 106 ACDF. ACDF is a fusion procedure, anterior cervical discectomy and fusion, and TDR is a total disc replacement or total disc arthroplasty, different names. And they said that artificial disc replacement scored better than ACDF or a fusion procedure. They also said that fusion patients were four times as likely to require an additional surgery. I've been doing this procedure for the last 25 years, and to me, especially this Western literature is complete rubbish. I'm into spine surgery for 30 years, including my training, and I have huge experience in this business. So if somebody tells me that you have four times chance of operating on a cervical fusion, after cervical fusion, it is complete rubbish because all of us who are practicing ACDF do not do that many revisions. We all know that. So whatever the Western literature says, the revisions for whatever the reason after ACDF is extremely low. In fact, any cervical spine surgery gives excellent results compared to thoracic spine surgery and lumbar spine surgery. It's the easiest to do, cervical spine surgery. The reason why we don't do it is because we don't get enough exposure during our orthopedic career as postgraduates and immediately afterwards. For some reason, we all go away from cervical spine surgery, the professors. Dr. Kern Singh, big name, Frank Phillips, Rush Institute. No bone grafting is required. You can also do a cervical discectomy and fusion without a bone graft nowadays. You can use artificial bone. There is no need to install a plate, yes, but then you have to install another device, if not a plate. Motion of the spine is maintained, which may protect adjacent levels from wearing out. Is this the whole truth? Certainly not. The whole problem started like our Mixter and Barr, who first described the cervical, the lumbar discectomy, and that went on till today to do unnecessary discectomies in the lumbar spine, which I find majority, at least in the city that I practice, are totally unnecessary. So is the same thing. This paper which said that 2.9% of incidence of symptomatic adjacent segment disease, that means the adjacent disc is wearing out after you do a fusion procedure because of increased loads on the disc above and below. So this started the industry to think in terms of producing an artificial disc. They thought that if we can give movement here, then we can avoid this problem of adjacent segment degeneration. Gore and Sipic, 50 patients with ACDF and 21-year follow-up. Look at that. Only 8 required revision surgery in 21 years. That means it is a damn good procedure. You have to believe these sort of papers. Herkowitz randomized 44 patients, ACDF fusion from the front or posterior foraminotomy without fusion. It is like putting a disc there. That means you have preserved the motion. And see what happened. ACDF group, 40% adjacent segment degeneration, whereas foraminotomy, 50%. That means even if you don't fuse, the discs are getting degenerated at the adjacent levels. This is again a landmark Kaplan-Meier analysis by Hillebrand. Symptomatic ASD, onset of myeloradiculopathy requiring surgery, reported only 2.9% of increased ASD, but 25.6% developed new clinically significant disease with 10 years of index fusion. but the overall surgery rate is extremely low. But what he forgot to look at in that landmark analysis, so-called, is the natural history. If you look at Leto's paper in Neuroradiology 1994, all of us who are above 40 years of age develop, 62% of us develops disc degeneration, osteophytes, narrowing, etc. But if you look at the overall surgery rate for a cervical disc is less than 10% in most of our series. If you are above 65 years of age, 95% of men and 75% of women at least one level of disc degeneration, and majority of these do not require surgeries. So will TDR reduce disc replacement, the risk of adjacent segment degeneration? The present data raises significant doubt as to whether cervical TDR will reduce or eliminate adjacent segment degeneration. That is in 2012, as recent as that. So they have analyzed lots of papers and found no evidence that it would reduce the adjacent segment degeneration. Nonetheless, just 2.3% incidence of symptomatic ASD in 4 to 7 year outcomes in 5 different TDRs. It is more or less the same thing as an ACDF, which is a much simpler, straightforward, and perhaps cheaper procedure. 6 different TDRs, 41.5 months follow-up, Murray et al., 2009, no difference in the rate of additional surgery for ASD in both disc replacement and fusion. So why are we doing this more expensive and slightly more complicated procedure? US FDA studies, look at this. This is again an industry-driven study to see which discs are to be released into the market. ProDisc versus ACDF, 24 months data. No statistically significant difference between ACDF and a disc. In the VAS score, results for neck pain or arm pain, nor neurological outcomes. So they are all doing the same, both the disc replacement and the ACDF. Yes, there are two papers here. Mumaneni is an Indian, Heller et al. They found better neurological improvement and success rates with total disc replacement, greater improvement in neck disability, but again for a short-term follow-up, but no statistically significant difference in the rate of secondary procedures. So if you look overall in the long term, there is no difference between the procedures. And it's interesting from Bradley's paper, multi-level fusion led to less ASD, adjacent segment degeneration, compared with a single-level fusion. That is a very interesting finding indeed. Movement, loss of motion depends on pre-op movement. In most series, this is not documented, most meta-analysis. What was the pre-op range of movement to say that the movement has increased or decreased? But if you look at it, actually, after ACDF, because of the pain, etc., decreasing in the patient, they may have a better movement after ACDF. It may not be new movement, but they get the original movement after pain relief. So therefore, in conclusion of all these papers, outcomes for artificial disc compared to ACDF are similar, but long-term results of motion preservation and adjacent level disease, that is which why we are doing a disc replacement, are not yet proven as on today. This paper, Bartels, 2010, meta-analysis of randomized clinical trials concluded cervical disc prosthesis unjustified compared to fusion. So they found it unjustified. And they found that this treatment, which has more complications, should go into more clinical and closed monitoring of the data. And they also found that people with cervical disc replacement require longer term follow-up because of the potential complications of these problems. Disc replacements cannot supplant arthrodesis. You cannot do a disc replacement in many conditions. The FDA has contraindications for in DISH, severe spondylosis, spondylolisthesis, three or more levels, three-level disc replacement is also common, is done in India also by some surgeons, severe osteoporosis, etc. Pickett et al., 100% of patients with Bryan and TDR had a mean change of -6 degree kyphosis at follow-up, but this kyphosis may not be significant. Again, disc replacement cannot be done in infection. It cannot be done in local tumor metastasis. Axial pain, if your patient has only neck pain, axial pain, it's not an indication. Severe facet arthritis, morbid obesity, HIV, hepatitis B, these are all FDA contraindications, but they are not contraindications for an ACDF. Chronic steroid use, trauma, systemic disorders, insulin-dependent diabetes, this list goes on and on. Cervical disc can preserve but cannot restore normal spinal kinematics. You cannot compare a cervical disc with a lumbar disc. Lumbar disc is already in disrepute, but the idea of doing a lumbar disc is to restore normal spinal kinematics. That is not the same with a cervical disc. The purpose of cervical disc is to just give you movement so that we do not get adjacent segment problems. Therefore, cannot be utilized again in people with ankylosing spondylitis, etc., where you have to do a fusion. It is the best candidate is a young patient. But there are problems. What about the longer use? Is there more wear and tear, like your surface replacements in hip joints? If you have to remove them for whatever reason, you have to do more bone dissection due to osseointegration. Perhaps that's not a big problem. Dysphagia. Some papers say that there is more dysphagia with cervical plates, but if there is no cutout, I have not found that to be a big problem in my patients. But Anderson et al. Found 24 out of 242 patients with total disc replacement compared to 16 out of 221 with ASDF had dysphagia. That means more disc replacements had dysphagia than plating. Heterotopic ossification, this is a big problem. At 12 months, they found 44.6%, and at 24 months, 58.2% after disc replacement. Lung et al., 62% of patients had less than 2 degrees of motion because of this. So the whole idea of preserving motion goes for a toss when there's only 2 degrees of movement after you do a cervical disc replacement. This is a slide. This is borrowed from the books, from the net. See the heterotopy. This is significant ossification here, and there is complete ossification in another patient. So you have to watch out for this as well. There are other problems like implant migration, subsidence, wear debris, metallosis, vertebral body fractures. In the limited series that I have, I didn't have this problem. This again you see here, how the inferior plate has migrated forwards 6 months after surgery. And you see the reaction, metal reaction in the bone, these oscillating areas. These are also some of the complications of this procedure. As I said, I keep doing these procedures by select very carefully whom I do. And like a endoscopic discectomy that I do, the reason I do these procedures is more patient demand than for any scientific advantage. I stop here with this conclusion from Bradley again in 2012. Cervical total disc replacement does not at this time appear to represent a new gold standard for the treatment of cervical spondylotic radiculopathy or myelopathy. For the young surgeon who is keen to do these procedures, do not be carried away. Do a procedure that is easy and gives you fantastic outcomes in the long run and leaves a patient very satisfied. I thank you.
I will call upon Dr. Mohapatra to put this foot forward to give arguments for TDR.
Hi, good morning. Hi, good morning, everybody. I'll just start off with a slide that the failure of a cervical disc replacement is the best result of ACDF, this anterior cervical discectomy and fusion. But still, when we have a case of disc degeneration with radicular pain, there's a lot of confusion among the patients that whether to go ahead with the surgery, to be needed to be treated with conservatively, whether to go for a fusion, whether the fusion needs a bone grafting or just need to do a disc replacement. So where are we? Who is correct? And so before we go into the literature behind the disc replacement, just touch a little bit on normal anatomy. The functional spinal unit is represents the smallest segment of the spine that exhibits biomechanical properties of the entire spine, which comprises of two adjacent vertebrae, intervertebral disc, and spinal ligaments. and the disc, and it is exquisitely designed to provide a remarkable combination of stability, mobility and load. So the disc provides stability, facilitated movement, absorbs the shock, separate the intervertebral body and neural foramen. Primarily, it's a load-bearing and stabilizing structure of the functional spinal unit. The annulus fibrous is the structure makes the annulus ideally suited to bear the tensile hoop stress. And the nucleus pulposus is made to suit to bear the and redistribute the compressive loads. The facet joints provide secondary load bearing and stabilizing functions in the functional spinal unit. Coming to the kinematics, the changes in kinematics caused by significant perturbation of the normal IR, is the instantaneous axis of rotation, can result in excessive facet joint or posterior ligaments loading. The magnitude of the functional spinal unit motion varies at different levels of the spine and between individuals. Oncovertebral, the cervical disc experienced significantly less axial loads than the lumbar spine. That's why the disc replacement in the cervical spine can persist for a long time without wear and tear. The diseased functional spinal unit, with the onset of the degeneration of the disc, the nucleus loses its ability to bear compressive loads like a flat tire, and the load transfer is concentrated in the periphery of the vertebral end plates. So the pain from the degenerated disc can come from compressed neural structures, degenerated facet joints, the disc itself, and from the eccentrically loaded vertebral end plates. The conservative management is the mainstay of the treatment. Even at the moment, when 100 patients come to an OPD, 90% of them are treated conservatively. Surgical option is to be considered only when conservative measurement fails. Going to the natural history of the degenerated disc, 50% paper by Gore et al, 50% of the patient, even in 15-year follow-ups, continue to have the persistent symptoms of radicular pain. So the indications of the surgery is a confirmed cases after 4 to 6 weeks of conservative treatment if the patient symptoms are severe and functionally incapacitating or there is progressive neurological deficit. So what are the options of surgery we have? It is either anterior cervical discectomy with fusion or without fusion, a foraminectomy anterior posterior, or an artificial disc replacement. Now, for a long time, the ACDF has been a long standard, the gold standard treatment, but it has its own inherent problems like pseudoarthrosis, non-union, graft subsidence, adjacent segment disease, and graft side morbidity, and there is ample evidence in the literature about these problems. The long-term outcomes of the ACDF has shown to have 85% to 95% good results, and the success rates have improved over the years. And in some papers, it has reached 90% and more and still being considered as the gold standard. But the biomechanical studies have shown that cervical fusion alters the adjacent segment level kinematics. And there is increase in motion at the adjacent segments. And further, by cadaveric studies, finite element studies, and animal studies have inputs and stress that fusion increases intradiscal pressure, end plate stresses, and annular stresses at adjacent segment. So, what is an ideal procedure? The ideal procedure is that which the results which is as equal as a ACDF and which obviates the need for the bone graft harvesting or bone graft substitutes. So, question is whether it's a disc replacement. So why a disc replacement? The disc replacement because it preserves the segmental cervical motion leading to decreased incidence of ASD due to a reduced pressure on adjacent segment and facet joint, early return to work, shorter hospital stay, lower rate of reoperations at the index level or adjacent segments, and avoidance of problems of pseudoarthrosis and graft-related morbidity. It's already been discussed, Dr. Raghav Dutt, but most of the papers which came in early were industry sponsored by the FDA ID studies, but Of late, when we look at the literature, there's more and more paper coming out on cervical disc replacements. And apart from the ID studies, they have shown good results. And the midterm, not on the short term, but 4 to 5 year studies have also shown good results. Again, there's a lot of evidence extending into the adjacent segment disease. There's one paper, Gore and Sepik, that 14% of the patient underwent additional surgery for additional adjacent level disease after ACDA with an average follow-up of 21 years. So 14% is a quite significant amount. Again, and this is a recent paper by Daniel, Eric and Frank in 2011, where they showed an in vivo quantitative radiographic analysis showing that there is increased or movement in the adjacent segment. TDR, they did a total disc replacement with a porous coated motion implant, and which could restore and maintain the lordotic alignment and disc height and maintain the angular motion while allowing for similar translation to that seen before surgery. In contrast, after ACDF, the superior adjacent level developed increased angular motion compared with preoperative range of motion. This study provides in vivo data regarding the functioning of TDR and ACDF and their respect on impact on adjacent level kinematics. Again, there's a contrasting paper, Gore and Sepik, that there is no correlation between the radiographic findings and development of symptoms. And Hilbrand also found out that ACDF at more than one level led to significantly lower the rate of adjacent leg segment than fusion at one level. So does it only reflect the consequence of altered biomechanics or it represents the natural tendency of the degeneration with aging? It was further, now this is a recent publication in 2013, it's not yet published, it's accepted, where they found that they did a meta-analysis of all the prospective studies on TDR comparing the ACDF, and they didn't find any difference of adjacent segment disease between the two groups. So we need further long-term studies to prove that whether this is being really caused by the fusion procedures. So the further the pseudoarthrosis and bone graft site problems have been discussed in the literature. So this is a new paper by Dr. Upadhyay, where they analyzed all the three IDE-FDA studies, and they found out that there is no statistical difference in the two groups on NDI, neck disability index, and SF36, neck pain or arm pain. But the important thing is the segmental motion, sagittal motion was preserved in the TDR group, and the incidence of second operation was reduced, particularly for the adjacent segment degeneration. In addition, there was a statistically significant increase in neurological success, which indicated a maintenance or improvement in neurological status via motor, sensory, or reflex examinations. Another paper by the Rick Delameter and Jack Jigler, which showed a 5-year follow-up of prospective randomized clinical trial, revealed 5-fold difference in reoperation rates when comparing patients who underwent ACDF, that is 14.5%, with patients who underwent TDR to 2.9%. This finding suggests the durability of the TDR and its potential to slow the rate of adjacent level disease. The paper by Blumenthal and Jack Jigler in Spine 2013, they again showed that the reoperation rate in ACDF patients are higher. And the Kaplan-Meier survival analysis also found that the TDR group had a significantly longer survival period before undergoing reoperation than anterior cervical fusion. It's a systemic study by Ronald Lehman, and they found out that biomechanical simulations indicate that cervical disc implants may be durable beyond the currently reported length of clinical follow-up. There were 3 articles on biomechanical wear simulations, and device were tested between 10 to 20 million cycles in axial loading. And one study suggested such simulation may represent 50 or more years of wear in actual patients. Further evidence on less reoperation rates, and that this is a paper by Mumaneni, that cervical disc replacement is a viable treatment option for cervical herniated disc spondylosis or radiculopathy, resulting in improved clinical outcomes and maintenance of normal segmental motion and low rates of subsequent surgical procedures at 4 to 5 years of follow-up, not 2 years, which were the initials. But more studies with long-term follow-up are warranted. Now, coming to the cost effectiveness, there was a big this study in Journal of Neurosurgery Spine 2013. They have shown that it's still difficult to say whether it's still cost effective or not, but the device has to survive for at least 14 years to establish a greater cost effectiveness than ACDF. So it's not yet proved. Still further long-term studies are needed. Apart from degenerated disc, papers have come out where they have shown that good results are also found in myelopathy patients. But cervical disc replacement also comes with some disadvantages. It's already been discussed by Dr. Raghav that, like, it can happen, you can have mechanical failure, dissociation, migration of the implants, heterotrophic ossification, concerns about wear and tear, subsidence of implants have been reported, and even adjacent segment degeneration have been reported in cervical disc replacements. And there are certain situations where cervical disc replacements are contraindicated, like multi-level disease, combination of anterior and posterior disease, severe osteoporosis, spondylolisthesis, kyphosis, tumor, trauma, infection. So we can conclude that careful patient selection is perhaps the most important factor influencing the outcome of cervical discectomy with or without fusion. Use of a standardized operative procedure with an attention paid to detail maximizes the chances of successful outcome. Various studies have shown ACDF or ADR to be satisfying procedures for both the patients and surgeons. There have been very few comparative studies and have revealed more or less similar clinical results. However, some studies on individual procedures suggest some differences. Cervical disc replacement prevents the graft donor site morbidity and allows more rapid resumption of unlimited activities. It also supposedly prevents exaggerated adjacent level degeneration. However, long-term follow-up is required for concluding definitively in this regard. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions from the audience?
Lads, please. Lads.
From heart of heart, Dr. Mahapatra,
yeah.
What do you think about when you should do a fusion and when you should do, Raghav, a disc replacement?
Actually, we have all answered. We have all answered the question. There is no this.
Yeah, I know. It is actually a compromise, and we still don't have the full answer.
There is no concrete evidence that which is good or which is bad. But
from your experience, that's what I'm asking. Not from the literature.
If the patient is a young patient, below 40 years, there's good movement in the functional spinal unit, at least 8 to 10 degrees of movement. There's no listhesis or less than 3 millimeter of listhesis. Then I definitely do a total disc replacement, but clinically I have to exclude that the pain, there is no pain coming from the facet joint also.
I think Samita, you asked the same question which Abhay Nene asked in Coimbatore, two surgeons, one from New Zealand and one from Galicia, I think, if I remember. Both presented their work on cervical disc replacement, and they said if you were to have, both of you, a cervical disc problem, what would you prefer? And I remember the answer, both of them said fusion.
but if you ask me what I will have, I'll have a disc replacement at the moment.
Have a disc replacement. I think the honest answer is there's no difference.
There's no difference.
There's no difference. But then it is certainly an operation for a youngster. There's nothing wrong in doing a disc replacement youngster.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I'll tell you something. To do a disc replacement, you need experience. That's for sure. That's for sure. A surgeon who has not done at least 30 or 40 fusions should not attempt a disc replacement. You should not. Because it requires a bit more delicacy in approach, a bit more knowledge in cutting, in repairing the end plates.
End plates.
You have to make sure that both end plates are parallel to each other. All these things require a bit more experience. Just by doing a few of these, you should not go into it.
At the moment, it is patient demand.
It's patient demand. You put your name outside the board as a consultant spine surgeon. You're expected to do everything that you would do to Obama's wife with Bangladesh money. So that is a problem, especially in cities like Hyderabad. You get all these extremely highly educated patients, at least in my practice, and you can't get away saying that I do it. So what I do in my practice is I never give them a choice. I tell them, look, you have this problem. I show them on the MRI, this is pressing. And you have tried so much of physiotherapy, tablets, etc. You think you are in severe pain, you go for surgery. And when they say surgery, I'll tell them, I will put a plate and fix it. 90% of them would accept it. Let's say, doctor, what about it? Replacement. They say, both are sick. Then they say, you do your best, because they come with full trust in us. If somebody calls you from US and saying that you should do at least replacement, then we tell them, we'll do this. This is the advantage, this is the disadvantage. And that's fine. The other advantage of doing it, cervical disc is, you can put a higher fee for a cervical disc replacement than for an ACDL. So no difference, but select your patient carefully and do a very good job with this replacement.
I think what is best in your hands, you do it.
If you can't, that's true, but you can't be good at it unless you do ACDFs for a while. Do you agree with me on that?
Absolutely.
Yeah, you have to do a few of
these. I'm sorry? Yes, yes. Other way around is...
Absolutely.
It is a cosmetic surgery. Just removing the plate, hammering in... disc in the place of a cage or whatever.
But we can convert a disc replacement into a fusion. That is
the answer for disc problems, but the other way around?
No. We should not.
Thank you, both the speakers. And we come on to the next session.
Now we start the next session, and that is the panel discussion on the cervical spondylitic myopathy, anterior versus posterior spine surgery. Is there Harshvardhan Hegde? Our Ram is not here. You want to speak something? Is there anybody? Uday Pawar, Ankur Nanda, Mihir Bapat. There is nobody here.
No, we are all there. Yeah. Yeah. But we need the moderator to start
the symposium is not there.
To start
who is the moderator?
Ramchandra. Maybe he'll come on time.
You can go to the next session.
Not your time. Not your time
for the 12 o'clock.
11:30. Now we start the next session, and that is the Dr. Harshvardhan Hegde is here.
Yes.
You can speak. You can start. Okay.
So first is the
anterior versus posterior surgery in the cervical spondylitic myopathy.
Myopathy is cancer.
Myopathy
is cancer.
Yeah,
we do the session.
Session chal raha hai. Iske baad hai. MIS options in the lumbar degenerative spine. Yes. Now we invite MIS options in the lumbar degenerative spine. Dr. Arvind Kulkarni. Start the lecture.
Good morning, dear friends. Dear chairpersons.
This is your talk.
Do I like it? Pura load.
Dear chairpersons and my dear friends. Minimal invasive surgery is beautiful, it is elegant, and it is the future. Now, for a long time, long time, we did not have MIS options in spinal surgery. Our laparoscopic colleagues are well versed in doing minimal access surgeries, because what they have is, what we don't have, when we do posterior surgery, that is, we don't have cavities. So if you have a, if you're a urologist, if you're a laparoscopist, you can wound your toys in the abdomen and pelvis and operate. But we don't have a cavity here unless you go anterior. So thoracoscopic spine surgery was there, but MIS surgery, you know, which is more applicable in the lumbar spine, which is the most frequent area that is visited by us, was not there until a time came when surgeons came out with a technique of creating a temporary cavity by inserting a series of dilators and then using a port as your working portal came up with. So using these ports, we can do 80% of our degenerative work, and degenerative work forms 80% of our practice. So in a phenomenal number of patients, this particular technique is applicable. So what we do here is we dilate the intermuscular plane using a series of dilators of increasing diameters, then use ports. These ports vary in diameters ranging from about 16 to 22 mm, and these are the ports through which you operate and perform different procedures. Now I'll show you a few applications. This is an obese lady with an extra foraminal disc herniation. Operating on her, and going in this plane is traumatic both for the patient, for the surgeon, and it is something which you would try to avoid and treat the such patients with conservative treatment. But with the application of this minimal access, the tube is directly in the extra foraminal area. What it took for me was just 15 minutes of operative time without any bony work, without any bleeding. So I was exactly on the spot and pulled the disc out with a very small, tiny little scar there, which is not even very evident. So this is the beauty of minimal access. It is definitely cosmetically, applicable. There is basic science study to show that this it is associated with less tissue trauma compared to open surgeries or micro surgeries. Interleukin levels, CRP, these are acute phase reactants. They increase whenever there is trauma to the body, whether it is operative or any kind of trauma. So it's been shown, basic studies have shown that the degree of rise in CRP and interleukin 6 is low in tubular surgeries. Again, the amount of retraction that is possible within this tube on the nerve root is minimal. So intraoperative EMG studies have shown that there is less nerve root irritation with this particular technique when you ask your assistant to retract the nerve root.